allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Mrs. Mayor, if you would do the roll call, please.
Absolutely. Gary Dunlap.
Here.
Tom Cruise.
Here.
Alex Zachary.
Here.
Cheryl Hancock.
Here.
Anita Shekosinski.
Here.
Myself, yes. Tim Menninger.
Here.
And Lisa Collins. I think she's in Washington, maybe, right?
I don't know. I thought she was coming home, but I...
Oh, okay.
But, yes, yeah, so we will mark her excused.
All right.
So I would just note that six of the seven school board members are present, and we have a quorum. I would ask you to take a look at your board norms, either on the file in the Dropbox or in your blue folder this evening. Approval of the agenda. I would note that the agenda has been posted, distributed, and sent to local media. With this in mind, are there any changes? Seeing none, I would entertain a motion to approve the agenda as published.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? Okay, all those in favor of approving the agenda as published, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Public participation. Is there anyone who wishes to address the board relative to any item at this time? We ask that a 5-minute time limit per person be followed. Please come forward, state your name, address, and topic to be addressed. And I'm not seeing anyone coming forward, so let's move on to recognition and thank yous. Dr. Carlson.
Thank you. This evening, three things I want to share with you. First of all, we have an anonymous donation of $5,000 to be directed towards the band uniform drive. And so thank you, anonymous donor, for your generous donation to our high school band department specific to the band uniform. And needless to say, your support is greatly appreciated, quite generous. Also, we have two recognitions, special weeks coming up, and begin with Transportation Recognition Week. And so February 10th through the 14th is time when we celebrate those that work for transporting our students back and forth. And I do want to mention, I think I had just forwarded to the board too, it was such a nice compliment from Viterbo about some of our drivers and their experience with them. And so it's just another such a great thing about our transportation. It's a great department, and they do wonderful things for our kids and our parents. So it is a special week. We'll be acknowledging them. I think they'll be out and about too, some opportunities visiting our schools and serving lunch and so on. And I think Wednesday a couple of us are going over to celebrate them and recognize them as well. And then finally, another special week coming up where we recognize annually a group of students in an organization throughout the country, our FFA. And we have a couple members with us this evening, and I'm going to invite them to make some comments. And also, there's a list of activities. I believe it's in your board packet, the list of activities, and thought it'd be great to bring some even more special attention to those. So welcome. If you want to just come up to the side, and Alex, if you want to.
All right, thank you. As you can see in your packets, we have a full week for National FFA Week this year. Our chapter likes to use the week as a sort of recognition for our students and a way to reinforce our community ties. Monday, we focus on student development with our Ag Olympics, which is just some fun and games to kick off the week. Tuesday is our official dress day, where we wear our official dress to school, just to show off a little bit of what our organization does and gain some recognition within the school of who's all in FFA. We also bring meat and cheese trays as an appreciation around to district staff that helps us out throughout the year. Wednesday is our cinnamon roll run for local farmers. where we bring hot cinnamon rolls out for breakfast for them at about 5:30 to 6. We're always back at school by the time school starts, so it's an early morning for everyone. And then Thursday is student development as well, where we all get together and have lunch together in the ag room. And then this year, as a kickoff to FFA week, we're having a hypnotist show on Thursday the 19th. It starts at 7, and $1 of the $5 tickets are going to be donated to charity.
Well, great. Anything else?
My name is Anna Kaufman Schwartz. I'm the president of our FFA chapter. I visited the board earlier this year, but for anyone. And
I'm Alex. I'm the treasurer. I run the concession stand. I know a few of you have bought some stuff. Oh, that's cool.
Okay. I've got a question. I can't make out what is the logo? What's on that? I can't. What is that?
The emblem. Yeah, there's a big one on the back.
You can explain this.
I still can't really. All right. Can you explain it to me?
So this you have. It's set on a corn. If you cut it in half, and there, oh, where are you?
I'm showing them.
Oh, okay. little corn kernels circling that. You have an owl. It's symbolic of wisdom, our advisor. When we do opening ceremonies, each one of us has a symbol where we're stationed. Our advisor is the owl. The plow, tillage of the soil, it's supposed to symbolize hard work and dedication. Is that the vice president?
Yeah.
The president is the setting sun?
The rising sun.
The rising sun, all right. And that's a new age in agriculture. I'm the treasurer. I'm stationed by Washington. Washington isn't on here for some reason. That's kind of stupid, but that's okay. And then here's the eagle. Should we just walk around and show them?
Yep.
And then, do you want to do your part?
Walking. Oh, yeah. Well, I don't actually recite my part, though.
You don't recite your part? Okay, what do you recite?
I say the closing ceremonies, which is, as we mingle with others, let us be diligent in labor, just in our dealings, courteous to everyone, and above all, honest and fair in the game of life. That's the president's part.
And then I do the treasurer, stationed by the Emblem of Washington. Duties there. I keep a record of all receipts and disbursements just as Washington kept his farm counts carefully and accurately. I encourage thrift among the members and strive to build up our financial standings through savings and investments. George Washington was better able to serve his country because he was financially independent.
Interesting. Wow.
And
awesome.
It says Holmen. Anyone can't read. Wisconsin. Yep.
Thank you.
How long have we been
at? We've been a chapter for 76 years in the Holmen School District.
I was going to comment that it's nice to see that your brand or your clothing hasn't changed much since I was in school. You know, that's the whole recognition thing, but it is recognizable, and it's nice to see that we have 75 years of tradition. It's a long time, and I know that it takes quite a bit to become elected an officer in our local chapter. I know Alex, I judge gymnastics, and the women told me that when I at a meet I wasn't at, that the concession stand came and offered them treats, and that's nice. No other schools do that for us like that. We get water at other schools, but not the treats part. So it was just a nice little touch, I think, that we see often in Holmen, those special things that make Holmen what it is. And so thank you for your leadership in the club and in the school district. And congratulations, and sounds like you have a full week. And thank you for all the activities that you undertake, because I know FFA is quite a special organization within the district. So thank
you.
Can
I say a thank you, too? As a retired teacher, FFA in Holmen has nobody equal to them. You have sponsored so many life-changing events for elementary schools and all ages of schools, and so much work. But you're like out of the box. The people who lead you and those of you who are leadership as young people, there's no comparison. There is no comparison within this county.
Thank you, Kate.
You guys are the tops.
You know, we take the fourth graders every year to tour the farms, and I would like at this time to formally invite the board if they wanted to individually hop on a school bus and, you know, tour the farms and see what our organization does.
You do that this coming week?
No, that'll be cold in May.
I believe.
Just make sure you keep the board, keep us informed when that happens, because sometimes they may take you up on that.
Yeah, so. It would.
I'm not sure of the exact dates, but I do know it'll be the Tuesday and Friday of the week of May 10th. I can't remember if the 10th is that Tuesday or Friday.
Okay. Well, great, and thank you so much. And both these recognitions, we have proclamations as part of the board packet, and they also are on the consent this evening that you'll be voting on. Thank you.
Nice job representing your organization. Very
thank
good.
You very much.
Thank you. Okay, then we will continue on with our agenda. Thank you so very much. We are blessed to have our representative, Steve Doyle, here with us this evening, and he is coming forward. Steve, thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule. It's much appreciated. And I know that we sent some questions. We may have communicated them with your staff, just some things, but if you want to start out with some introductory comments, and we can.
Sure, although if you really liked me, you wouldn't have put me after them. I mean, they just show me up every time they're here. You know, it's so exciting. As part of my job, both here in Madison, having people that are involved in FFA or 4-H or DECA or those other organizations that I get to visit at their meetings, or they come to visit me in Madison. And you just know when you look at them and you listen to them that we're in good hands with this next generation. And that's why you do what you do, to make sure that we help to foster that growth that they have. And I'm so proud when I listen to them and talk about all the things that they're doing. I'd like to say that I'm always proud about what we do in Madison, but you know, it is what it is, and sometimes it gets a little frustrating down there, and sometimes it's actually fairly rewarding. We're in a time right now that there's a saying, may you live in interesting times. I think that we are living in interesting times in Wisconsin right now, and I want to talk about the budget process that we're starting the formal part of right now, and then I can answer questions that you have. Let me kind of give you almost a civics lesson approach on the budget as it stands right now. The budget process actually started way last summer with the department heads putting together their various requests for funding, and that was submitted to the governor in the fall and goes through the Department of Administration and his budget crunchers over the couple months after that. Last week we had the formal presentation of the budget to the joint meeting of the state legislature, and it's kind of interesting because you kind of think that, well, okay, you're gonna have the governor come in, whether it's this governor or any other governor, and tell you, here's what I'm doing, and you know, here's what to expect. But really, those budget presentations by the governor tend to be more of a political statement as opposed to a nuts and bolts. And it's really not until the next day frequently that we actually find out what is in the governor's budget. And that's how it was this year with the budget presentation. Governor Walker came in and said kind of an overview of some of the things, but really didn't get into it. The only new thing that we had learned was I can't even remember what it was. There was some small topic that he had just kind of dropped in there. But we had already heard about, the opening up of the vouchers. We had already heard about some of the transportation related things and so forth. And so those things were kind of on our mind as we listened to the governor. But you know, then we get presented with, this year it was an 1,890 page document that if you have a hard time falling asleep at night, you may want to start reading that, because it doesn't make any sense. It's all in legalese. It's actually the statutes that you can read it 10 times and not understand exactly what it means. So we have the tip of the iceberg right now. We've had the budget in the legislature in the Joint Finance Committee for a week now, and the different interested parties have all looked at their stuff. I just came from talking to the county board and, you know, the county's association person that night went through the budget and sent out a thing about 2 a.m. saying, here's what we see, you know, in the budget. I know the school board association does similar analysis and so forth. And so as that information comes in, we start to see what that picture looks like. And it is a picture of the early version of the budget. People always talk about, you know, the kind of the standard rule of thumb, if you will, is that the governor's going to get about 90% of what he puts in his budget, whether it's this governor or any other governor, because you really tend to find the legislature working around the edges. If you don't like something in the budget, it's not like you're starting from scratch and you need to get enough votes to create something. What you have to do is to get enough votes to get something out of the budget. If you don't have the votes to get it out of the budget, it stays in. And so by default, most of the budget is either not controversial or can't muster enough support to change and pull out things that are in there. So we know the general framework, but here's really, you know, where we're at. We have a budget where the governor has pledged we are going to have property tax relief, and that property tax relief will be on average $5 in each of the 2 years of the biennium. And so that's kind of the line in the sand that he has drawn. When I talked to the county board tonight, I said, you know, you guys, you know, and I'm still on the county board, I said, you know, we kind of dodged a bullet, because the good news for us was zero. I mean, we didn't get an increase, but we didn't really get a cut in things like shared revenue and general transportation aids and so forth. But the important thing is that that's where things stand today. And, you know, here's kind of how I want to, you know, maybe make my point here. If this is a pie and, you know, we're dividing up all of the different things in this pie, and, you know, schools may be here, you know, if we've got this pie and people say, if we don't like the fact that the governor is proposing bonding for transportation, I mean, that's one of the proposals, is the bonding program that is in place now, if there's a building that's already in construction, that can continue to get funded. If it's not started yet, for the next 2 years, it's not going to. Instead, all that money is going to get shifted over to transportation. Now, we've heard both Republicans and Democrats say they'd think that's a horrible idea. In fact, the Speaker of the Assembly, Robin Voss, was very critical of that idea and said, that's got to go. You know, so that is a lot of money. I think over $1 billion that we're talking about, you know, that's going to be funded that way. So if we say, well, that can't happen that way by taking it from somewhere else, that one's got to grow. What does that mean for the other things in the budget? If we say we will not expand this pie, if this pie is as big as it's going to get, because we're going to have this line in the sand that says we're not going to, you know, we're not going to not, to use a double negative, not going to not have property tax relief again this time, that means this pie isn't going to grow. So that means that if we fix some of the concerns that people have with regard to transportation, or the $300 million taken from the university, or the stewardship program, or senior care, or the various groups that we're hearing from saying, you can't take it from us, you can't do what you're proposing to do to us, then the Joint Finance Committee that has the budget now is going to have to shrink something else. That's where my concern is in terms of you know, the counties and you and you know, other you know, entities and programs that we have that need that state revenue to operate under. When we look at the budget today, as I said, we've had it for a week. It now goes to the Legislative Fiscal Bureau that will take about a month. And they will give us an analysis of exactly what is in that budget. And they literally do go through it line by line. And they really kind of put it into two pieces. Piece number one is the fiscal stuff, the things that you expect in a budget. Piece number two is policy, stuff that, and every governor does this, policy stuff that the governor sneaks in there that, you know, maybe they hope that people won't notice. Of course, the Fiscal Bureau people could find it, even if it was as small as a speck. And they pull that stuff out and they say, here are the pure policy items that are in the budget. And traditionally what the Joint Finance Committee has said is, okay, we're going to get rid of the policy stuff because this is not a place for policy. Introduce a separate bill if you want that to be done. So then that other piece is the big part of the budget, the various spending and taxing portions of the budget. And that's where then it gets even more interesting, as we're literally talking, trade-offs. You know, if we think that we need to put more money in transportation instead of bonding, is it going to come from K-12? Is it going to come from human services? Where is it going to come from? You know, are we going to raise gas taxes, for example, on that particular issue? And we have the leader of the Senate saying, no way, no how. Are we going to raise the gas tax? Okay, well, if that's off the table, that's where, I can tell you, again, we're seeing the tip of the iceberg today, but I can't tell you what the rest of that iceberg looks like. And nobody can tell you what the rest of that iceberg looks like because we haven't worked our way through the process so far. But here's what we know today. And you probably know maybe all of this already. The caps are proposed to be lifted on voucher enrollment. That was no surprise. We heard that, months and months ago that was going to happen. The trajectory, though, of what I see is a thing that concerns me. For funding for vouchers for 2015 and 16, 4.9 million. For 2016, 17, 12.3 million. 4.9 to 12.3. If that's the trajectory that continues, and we know where that money comes from. I mean, every dollar that goes to voucher school comes from you folks. We are starting down that path of having, two competing schools, the public schools and the publicly supported private schools or voucher schools. And when I talk to people, the folks on fixed income or who are struggling to make their mortgage payments and their property tax payments, they're not real anxious to support two school systems. And so we're going to see, I think that issue is going to get a lot of attention as this program grows. And let me tell you my own experience with that. 2 years ago, when we talked about vouchers, and some people were sounding the alarm that this is something that is going to be harmful to our public schools. This is something that is going to affect all of us around the state. We weren't really getting a lot of traction in this part of the state because people, they didn't know what a voucher was. They'd heard of that concept. Yeah, that's Milwaukee. That's not me. As soon as we got a voucher school in this area, boy, did I get the phone calls. Like, wait a minute, you're saying my taxes are not going for my school, they're going for those kids to go to that school, and a lot of those kids, two-thirds, three-fourths, are already in that school, and now we're paying for that? I mean, I heard just this, wake-up call from people that, oh, now I understand. This is in my community. This is going on here. And so I think that as the voucher program expands, we will see more and more of that. People finally saying, oh, this is real. This is staring me in the face. This is something that I understand now. And so I think that even though the caps are off of vouchers, that is going to be an issue that's going to be debated for a long, long time. I think that as more and more school districts see the impact on that, more and more property taxpayers, more and more parents, we'll see the impact on that. Funding for schools essentially is flat. I would argue actually going down. Expenses obviously continue to rise. And you better not screw up because under the proposal, we're going to be looking at doing to schools and school districts what we used to do to kids, A, B, C, D, or F. And I know that many schools are moving away from that and doing the more soft things like, showing progress or needs improvement or those kinds of things. And I was at a meeting this morning, the Chamber of Commerce Cracker Barrel, and Senator Schilling gave a really good example of what that means, not specifically to a school, but to a community. Can you imagine being a realtor trying to sell a house in a community where that school is getting a D or, God forbid, an F, and trying to convince this home buyer, well, don't worry about the school, they're getting a D, but, this is a great community. I mean, who is going to move their company, their family, into that community when something as stark as that is out there? And so, I think that is going to be problematic for the schools that perhaps for no fault of their own, are struggling, and whether they it is through the fault of their own or not, to get them on the right path. It seems to me that what you're doing is creating this vicious cycle where it just gets worse and worse because of the fact that now the perception is going to be out there that because this isn't a school that is worth saving, this is maybe not a community that's worth saving. You all know about, you know, Common Core and where the governor's at on that, and that the however many hundreds of thousands or millions of dollars that you've spent on that, you get to start over. I was talking with a school administrator this morning at that same meeting who said, you know, maybe we shouldn't give the test this year because it's not going to mean anything. Maybe we should save the money and forget about it. Because what are they going to do to us, you know, if we don't? You know, and I don't know how serious he was on that, but you know, it's that that kind of sense that, you know, how many times do we have to push this rock up the hill where we start pushing it up and then they change the hill, and now we have a different rock to put up or a different push up or a different hill to go up, and we just keep starting over. Settle on something and stick with it is what I keep hearing. The school accountability issue, there is very much a difference of opinion between the Senate and the Assembly, or I should say there started out to be a very different opinion on school accountability and how to measure that and how to enforce that between the Senate and the Assembly. I quite honestly can't tell you what the Assembly position is at this point. The chair or the author of Assembly Bill 1, the School Accountability Bill, Representative Thiesfeld, had his public hearing, got so much flack that he said, well, we're going to make a bunch of changes, and we're still waiting to see exactly what those changes would be. Hearing from my school officials throughout my district, by and large, you were more supportive of the Senate version of that. Where things will ultimately end up, you know, it's anybody's guess. So much of that wrangling seems to get done out of the spotlight, then we get a bill that people say, okay, here's the bill. And as you know, quite frequently we have very short amount of time to react to it after it gets, you know, put on our desks. I know my office has been sending out communication to the district administrators, to the school board members and so forth when things come up. And I really appreciate the feedback. And let me just give you an example. You know, when AB1 came out and we sent that out and people said, horrible, horrible, horrible. I thought, okay, well, that didn't surprise me. But then when people on Senate Bill 1 said, we might be able to work with this, I'm like, oh, you know, I would have assumed that people would have uniformly said we don't like it. But that people actually found some things to like in that approach, at least as a starting point. So if you can tell me, you know, this section is good, this section let's work on a little bit, that's very helpful to me to know. And so the people that do respond to me, I really do appreciate that. Probably a good point for me to stop and answer your questions.
Okay. Are there any questions specifically?
And if I can't answer, the FFA kids will answer.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got a question.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming.
Sure.
I appreciate it, really do. I've been a member of the board for almost a year now, and I've seen many very talented educators walk through these doors and present, and teachers and principals and stuff. Governor Walker has won 3 times in the last 4 years, and has maintained majorities in both houses of the assemblies. And he's always promoted this voucher program. So does that say anything about what the people want?
Trying to tactfully respond to that, there are some very generous people out there who like to make gifts on a biennial basis when it comes to be election time. And when you look at the voucher lobby in Madison, it is huge. Let me give you a couple of examples. There were 2 colleagues of mine that were defeated in this last election. actually three colleagues that were defeated in this last election, but I want to talk about one in particular, Mandy Wright from Wausau, who was is a teacher. Great person. I just love her to pieces. She just was such a good legislator. She was very much anti-voucher. In this last election, she was defeated. She raised over $100,000. Her opponent, I think a little bit under $100,000. But then the voucher people came in, and we haven't exactly figured out how much, but somewhere between $200,000 to $400,000 was spent against her. By the way, for a position that pays $50,000 a year. You know, so I mean, how can you counter that kind of thing? And if somebody gives you that kind of money, and I don't care if it's a voucher lobby or if it's a union or if it's an environmental group or the NRA, I don't care who it is, but if you get that kind of money, I think there's an expectation of some loyalty there. And that's what's broken with the system, is that it is way too money dependent. The days are gone of the citizen legislator who does it because it's the right thing. You still have that. I mean, in my days on the county board, you know, when a tough question came up and people were wringing their hands, you know, how are you going to vote on this? My attitude was, okay, so if I do what I think is the right thing and the voters disagree and they kick me off the county board, you know, I lose $3,000 a year. I can make that up doing, you know, whatever other job I want to be doing. And it wasn't the end of my life. But if you get people that are so ingrained that this is their job, their full-time job, and for me it's not, the state legislature, they tend to get a little too loyal, I believe, to the people that help them get there. And that's what's broken in our system, because both parties have that. And that needs to change.
You have your own practice, law practice, right?
Right. Although I do tell people that I run a nonprofit organization, but not on purpose.
Sure. Sure, I understand.
My time in Madison takes away from actual billing hours.
So my kids went to school here. They also did internet school. And they went, in 2008, they went with six busloads of other students and parents to protest the Governor Doyle's attempt to shut down internet school. And luckily, they won. And students won. And that student-centric is where we're at. Mm-hmm. So, as a school district, we face voucher schools. I actually talked to several teachers that were union-paying teachers that were furious with the union trying to shut their school down. But that's another story. That doesn't matter here tonight. Mm-hmm. So we're losing money. We're losing market share. What is your advice for this board to take to be more competitive? Because obviously, education is becoming more of a business as opposed to just a love of the industry, and I agree that anybody on this side of the table loves this industry. So what do we need to do as a board, in a real concise way, what should we do as a school district to be more competitive? Because I think this is the way of the future, and we have to be more competitive. I'm just curious, your thoughts, please.
No, I think that's an excellent question, and you should be more competitive. Whether you are competing with a voucher school or you're competing with Onalaska or West Salem, you need to be the best school possible, because we've always had, or not always, but for a long time, we've had school choice where you can jump school district lines if you choose to. So you do need to run like a business in that respect, and you have to produce a quality product. If people feel that your product is a higher quality than your competitor's product, whether you are a school district, whether you are a lawyer, whether you are a retailer, then the customers will come your way. What concerns me is that what we see is the erosion of some of the things that make our public schools special. You know, and I'm not a product of the public school. I went to Aquinas myself. My parents did. I sent my kids there, and I paid, even when I was in high school, I paid my own way. I didn't expect the taxpayers to pay. We didn't have nearly the array of options of things that we could get involved in when I was in school. The things that people really look at as special about their school, again, the FFAs and the DECAs and those kinds of things. You know, if you lose those things, if you lose your show choir, you lose some of your athletics and so forth, then people are going to start to, they're not going to leave in droves, but they're going to trickle away. And then someday in the future, you're going to wake up and, you know, think, you know, we were going like this with enrollment, and we were going like this, and now we're going like this, and it's not like this, but it's down a little bit. But if you keep going down that path, then, you know, ultimately you lose. And so I would say, focus on the quality, and do something that you don't do very well. And that is pat yourself on the back and trumpet your successes. Teachers work really hard, and I have told the teachers' unions this time and time again. You don't give yourself enough credit publicly for what you do. You know, we have this discussion going on at the state now where the governor said maybe university teachers need to teach another class, you know, and so now we've got some of the university faculty, and there was a story in the Tribune this weekend, you know, showing here's, you know, what I do all day, and I put in 16-hour days or longer. Our teachers need to make sure that the people who pay their salary, the property taxpayers and the people in this community, know the value of them. How many teachers out there go out and actually buy supplies for their classroom and never talk about the fact that they are out at Shopko or Walmart buying things for their classroom because their school can't afford it? People need to know that. People need to know what the teachers do in terms of one-on-one time with the students, what the teachers do in terms of extracurricular stuff that they may get paid a pittance for, or they might not get paid at all for. That's what people need to know about, because that message isn't getting out. People think teachers show up at 8 o'clock in the morning and they leave at 3 o'clock at night, and that's it for them. They shut off their brain and they don't deal with those kids until the next morning. That message has to get out.
Sure, I agree 100%. And last thing I'll say real quickly, I think that A to F rating for schools, I hope it incorporates parents, because I think that teachers are sidelined with a lot of BS, excuse my language, with parents who shouldn't be, who don't parent. So time is the only variable they have control over, or they have no control over.
And let me jump in on that, because you raise a really good point that was made at the meeting again this morning, is when you look at the schools that are not successful these days, the ones that you may define as failing, what is the common denominator? And almost always that common denominator is poverty. And you know, if a family is falling apart, there's maybe only one parent, and that parent is minimally employed or not employed, and those kids just aren't getting that direction, that those role models and so forth, they don't have the food in their belly to concentrate during the day, they don't really have that bright horizon to look forward to. Those kids, those families are what are failing first before our schools are. Our schools are the symptom of that failing, not the cause.
Schools anchor communities, without a doubt.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that's the message that needs to get out, you know, there. You know, people are saying how awful Milwaukee schools are, you know, and is it the Milwaukee School Board's fault? I suspect that there's a lot of things, but I think poverty is a big part of that.
Are there any questions? Other questions? Anita?
I just had a couple of comments. First of all, thank you very much for coming, Steve.
Absolutely.
And on behalf of all of us, I'm sure, and at least on behalf of me, thank you for all the work you do, especially considering you're also on the county board.
Well, it's a labor of love. I enjoy doing this just like you folks.
I know. I appreciate it from the bottom of my heart. Just one thing, a couple of things I wanted to say, but the first thing is just the point about the vouchers and the fact that the governor's been elected 3 times and he supports vouchers and the majority of the legislature supports vouchers. In 2012, the legislative districts were also redrawn and they were gerrymandered. If you Google gerrymander Wisconsin, every newspaper will have an article or an editorial about the gerrymandering, and the Republicans will admit the gerrymandering, but it was legal, so they could do it. So simply because they are in the majority doesn't mean that they are in the majority fairly. They were elected legally, but fairly is very, very questionable. I don't think that the majority of people in Wisconsin support vouchers. I would be willing to bet that the majority of people do not support vouchers.
You know, every politician, especially in the executive branch, that gets elected feels that they have a mandate. You know, I was elected because the people agreed with me on this. And again, in the executive branch, they're the ones that get most of the publicity, whether it's president or governor. You know, when Bill Clinton got elected in 1992, I believe it was, you know, he had a mandate for health care reform. Boy, that just happened right away, didn't it? You know, and so people feel that you're sending a message. If you voted for Walker, you must be in favor of everything he stands for. Or if you voted in favor of Tom Barrett or Mary Burke, you must be in favor of everything they stand for. It's really not that at all. And when I taught political science at the university, which I did for 28 years, I used to talk about that when we vote for our elected officials, we vote for a perception that what we think, and sometimes we just think it's a good guy or a good woman, or you know, they're from my community, or you know, I like their you know, dynamic. You know, Obama was very dynamic. People didn't know what hope or change meant, but they knew he was dynamic. So I think you're absolutely right, Anita, that doesn't mean that everybody in Wisconsin is in favor of vouchers or whatever, you know, else that the governor is pushing. But it does mean that is a debate that we need to have, because it's not done after the November election. I mean, then you go from campaigning to governing, and that discussion still needs to happen during the governing stage. We can't let up. I mean, whether it's, you know, funding for our schools or vouchers or whatever the issue is, you know, we need to make sure that we're heard. And if we don't, then, well, we know what the outcome is going to be.
Any other?
The other thing I wanted to ask, and I guess this might be putting you on the spot, and you may not have the answer to this, but I do know that our governor spends an awful lot of time not in Wisconsin, and right now is in London for a four-day, I don't know, political trip, whatever. And I know the taxpayers.
How many electoral votes does London have?
How many what?
Electoral votes does London have?
I don't know, but Chris Christie was there last week, and Bobby Jindal was there, and so how much does a trip like that cost? And does anyone at the state level ever say to him, would you please stay here and spend some time and roll up your sleeves and work with us? Could you put that stuff aside? Does anyone ever, even on the Republicans or the Democrats, it doesn't matter, but do they ever get tired of him being gone?
Well, let me answer that in two parts. If it's a political thing, then his campaign has to pay for it, even though the campaign is over. It can't be paid for by state funds. And, you know, what happens, you know, let me shift it from him to the president. You know, if the president flies somewhere for a fundraising event out in California, for example, and he flies there in Air Force One, he has to reimburse the government for the cost of a first-class ticket, you know, even though Air Force One is a little bit more expensive than a first-class ticket. You know, so I don't know how much actually the state is paying for the governor to go to London, for example, because that's, I think, probably a combination of official and campaign-related kind of stuff. But I can tell you that there are people who 24/7 are interested in looking under each rock there to make sure that if he spends an extra dime of taxpayer dollars than what is justified, they will make an issue of it. I mean, and if not within the state, then his Republican opponents in the primary will be trying to make an issue out of that. So I'm not real concerned that he's going to milk the taxpayers in that regard, that, you know, he's going to charge things that he shouldn't. But the bigger question that I want to address is the time away from the state. And I think that we saw that last week with the whole, you know, eliminating the word truth from the Wisconsin idea.
Yes.
You know, and first he said, well, it was a drafting error. Well, and then he changed his mind. It wasn't a drafting error. It was this miscommunication. And then now he's even back down on that when the Journal Sentinel found all sorts of stuff that said, no, there was no miscommunication. This is what you told them. I believe his position or his statement that this isn't what he wanted, that, you know, he said get rid of that. I think that what he said is, here's what I want to accomplish, and then he took his eye off the ball in the drafting of the budget because he was busy with other things, and so those things slipped through. I mean, I don't think it's an intentional or deceitful kind of thing. I just think that you can't be everywhere at all times and serve too many masters. And so, you know, if the main cook is leaving the kitchen, the other cooks may put some ingredients in there that maybe the main cook wouldn't have used. And I think that we're probably going to see more of that, and whether it's him or it's Chris Christie or anybody else who's running for office that currently has an office, you just can't do full duty to both. And I don't think this will be the last.
Other questions? Kate?
Thank you for being here tonight. Thank you also for your reputation of being probably one of the best people I know in my government that tries to reach out, and you've done some good stuff with that. You're still doing that. You and Republicans are working together on some really cool things with jobs and all kinds of things. With that said, when Jennifer was here, I think I used the word, I'm livid about some things. I'm going to use the word livid, but I'm going to be smiley and calm about using it. So here's a few things. One, I'm livid about removing the cap on statewide voucher programs. And our citizens, the few or the many that watch this show, because it's going to be out there, need to know that every child that gets money to go away from my school district, their kids that are left here in public education lose a whole lot of money. And I'll be specific on that when there are public hearings. We are cutting per student funding by $126.9 million.
You should be livid about that.
Enough said. But that is wrong. Our state is founded upon the basic principles of what the country is founded upon and what every first world country does with their public education. Some first world countries even have citizens that take pride in paying taxes for public education. Three, we have cut almost $90 million in funding for students with special needs. Those are my babies. As an ex-teacher, how would we ever do that? Those are families hurting already. Districts need to provide things. So you couple that with maybe somebody who takes a child away in that program, we lose all that money, plus they decide to cut $90 million for kids with special needs. Just don't get it. Here's my teacher heart talking too. You're gonna permit somebody with no background in education to take a single test because they know a bunch about the content, and they could teach, and they could be licensed teachers. Now, I don't have a problem with looking at technical areas, places where we have a need for teachers, ag teachers, farming people. I'm open to this kind of thing. But to make a broad statement that says anybody who can pass a test in their content could be a teacher, I will talk to every single one of my moms and dads, and I know the teachers they're going to ask to have their kids put into are not going to be that teacher. They're going to have them put into a teacher with a good reputation. There's a point in here in the budget that calls for cutting funding with school breakfasts, libraries, SAGE, gifted and talented students, school violence prevention programs. I had one more. The UW thing, I'm not going to go into that, but we all have kids that are, not all of us have kids. Many of our citizens have kids that go on to higher education beyond high school. And it's already so expensive. I have five daughters. Three of them have loans in the tens of thousands of dollars. When you have that many daughters, you can't pay for them to go to school. And they've got that. And these are things I just want you to represent our babies in and our families in that are struggling. And I know you will, but I am. I go back to that. I'm livid that everything I see in the budget, it's a bad word. I was going to say a tax. I'm going to choose another more positive word. Everything I see in the budget.
Tariff.
Hurts. Hurt. What did you say?
Tariff instead of taxes.
It's your turn to talk next. It just hurts the little people. the middle level people. And I didn't, you know, I'm on a, we're at a school board here, so I'm only speaking about school issues. I haven't talked about seniors and how they're going to be hurt and Medicaid and all of that. But everything I see in the budget seems to take away from the people that need it the most. While over the course of the last 5 years has given tax cuts and privileges to those who make a lot of money. Now, I'm glad people make a lot of money. I really am. We need them all. I want to be one of those people.
Not in this job.
But there has to be something. I mean, to me, this budget, and I have to stop talking because Cheryl knows I could go on for hours.
Yes.
And I'm going to stop. And so does Gary. But this is like values. It's like Wisconsin values. We have always taken care of, and we have set the standard for how to take care of those who need without embarrassment. So I just want you to know that we're hurting. I think you were here a year ago and you said something about school districts, among others, are really good at carrying on, and you don't let the public know how bad it is. I'm saying tonight to the public, this is really bad. This is really bad, and please help us.
Well, let me just say, Kate, that you should be livid, because the day that you lose your passion, you should walk away from this position. And that's what makes you such a great, made you such a great teacher and now such a great school board member, is that you do have that passion, and all of you here are here because you want to do the right thing for the kids. Let me address some of the comments that you made. You know, one of the concerns with the vouchers is that the money that the voucher schools get per student in many cases ends up at more than what the public school would have gotten for that kid. And if we ever start to run out of money, the vouchers get paid first. You know, and so you guys are the ones that get shortchanged, and the voucher schools are made whole. The special needs is an atrocity. The fact that the voucher schools don't have to deal with any of those sort of students. And what we're going to see is, you know, as more students or families are lured away from the public schools, it'll be the more expensive to serve students that are left behind. And you know, when we get to that point, then it gets really, really difficult to make ends meet and to have that community buy-in, that we are actually everybody. And then, because if we become a subset of the population, I think you lose that community buy-in. And so I hope we don't go down that route. You know, the comment about the teacher qualifications and the proposal that, you know, if you pass a test and you've got these life experiences, if you will, you know, there are countries around the world where teachers get paid more than doctors because they are valued for what they do for our next generation. You know, they are recognized as the ones that are creating that next generation of workers, of employers, of entrepreneurs, of leaders, you know, including political leaders. And I don't want a competent person to teach my children. I want a great person to teach my kids. I don't want to be average. I want our schools to be the best. And if we start to lower our sights, when do we go from being Wisconsin to being Mississippi? I mean, that's what I don't ever want to see us do. Because when you look at the history of Wisconsin during my lifetime, we've always been a higher tax state than many states around the country. But we still had people come here because they knew we had good schools. And if you ask, to go back to my realtor example, if you ask a realtor what the first question that somebody who's moving to that community asks them, they don't ask, you know, where's the nearest park or how many potholes are there in the roads. The first question they always ask is, what are your schools like? And if we say they're average, they're going to go to the next state or the next town. I mean, that we can't ever let that happen, because it it's good economic sense to have good quality schools. They are a magnet for the kind of people you want in your community, the people who are going to be successful, who are going to be the wealthy people, you know, that you talked about, Kate. You know, we need to encourage those people to come. And if we are satisfied with average, there's a lot of other average places that they can go to that doesn't have 6 months of winter. You know, and so we've got to be the best that we can. I'm very concerned about this issue of financial aid, as well I should, because I have two daughters at University of Wisconsin-Madison. I remember when I went to UW-La Crosse, I graduated with maybe a couple thousand or so dollars worth of student loans. We had grants back in those days, and my family was of modest means, and so I got a lot of help with that. I worked all the way through school also. But you look at students today graduating from college, and the worst of all, every year the dental students come to Madison, and I always ask them what the average student debt load of a graduating dental school student is. You know what that is? $265,000. You know, no wonder your teeth cleaning is so expensive when they graduate with that kind of debt load. But just your student graduating from college, you know, if it's even $25,000, $30,000, $50,000, you know, that's a car that they're not going to be buying. That's a home that they're not putting a down payment on. That may just be something as simple as a refrigerator or, a piece of sporting equipment or whatever, you know, that they're not putting into the economy, because that money is going to, you know, the Higher Education Aids Board or whoever it is that you're paying it to that's not in our state. It's not helping our local economy when that money is going away, where it could be used in our economy if they had that to spend here. And so that is so short-sighted. We need to figure out how to make college more affordable. When I went to UW-La Crosse, I was involved in student government, and we had a lobbying program that we did in I think it was my senior year, called Operation Tuition Check, where we had students at registration sign a thing asking the legislature to cap the percent of the cost of education that in-state students would have to pay at 33%. It's flipped now. I mean, now the state is paying less money than they ever had, so you've got inflation, and then you also have that double whammy of the state assisting you even less. It's no wonder the students and their families are having a hard time making ends meet. And if we have a generation of student, of young people who can't go to college and instead they just go straight into the job market, we're going to have a generation of minimum wage workers. That's not good for our state. I have always said, and I'll wrap up with this, you know, education isn't an expense, it's an investment. We have to remember that. And our taxpayers, I think, understand that. But we can't keep being the candidate who's running for office who's going to cut your taxes the most. We have to be the candidate that says, I'm going to make your community the best it can be. And we have to be willing to make tough decisions.
I got one quick question.
Yeah.
Are we losing population in Wisconsin? I know that we're losing people.
We are.
And that was before Walker was elected. That was before Walker was elected, wasn't it?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Why?
Taxes? Taxes are, well, every person that leaves has their own reason, but the studies have shown that taxes are a part of it, but not a big part of it.
I don't care about that.
A huge part of it is the weather. I mean, people go from here to Arizona where they don't have to deal with winter.
The less people here, the less income we have to share.
But there's research that says, Tom, too, that it's the salary. What if you look at what our wages are in Wisconsin is below Minnesota and Illinois. And so if they can go and have the same weather, go to Minnesota, go to Illinois, and get paid better for the same degree, why wouldn't they?
You said something about how we can, these schools will lose value, and then they start having this lower. It's really important, I think, that everyone comes together. Some are really high achievers, and some are less. Aren't so high, they're more hands-on. The mixing of that group brings all the stones higher.
Oh, absolutely, and you know, Cheryl was alluding to that concept called brain drain. You know, people, they come to our world-class university system, and at the day of graduation, they'd love to stay in Madison because they love the community, but if they can't get a job there, bam, where do they go? Minneapolis, Chicago. I mean, so they're not going to Arizona, they're going to a place where they can you know, make a lot more money. So we have to be willing to pay people what is competitive. And that's where, you know, when people talk, you know, the area where the state has control, like say on university professor salaries or teacher salaries at K-12 level, and we say, well, what's the cheapest we can get by? Well, you know, if that's what we're looking at, we're going to get average teachers, and people that want to go into the teaching profession aren't going to want to be here, and people aren't going to get the quality education. I was on the study committee for the university system 2-3 years ago that looked at this idea of more flexibility for the university, which is now the governor's talking about. But I learned one really interesting statistic in that committee. Between federal grants, research grants from private and governmental sources, the University of Wisconsin system brings in $1 billion per year. $1 billion that comes from outside, from the federal government, from private entities, and so forth. And many of those dollars are tied to a particular professor. So if we say to this professor, you know, maybe you need to work another class or teach another class, that professor may say, you know, I'm going to go to this other university and they're not going to require me to teach another class because I want to do more research or I want to be able to devote more time to the students that I have. And that money, that may be hundreds of millions of dollars in their case, is going to go with them. We have to keep that in mind too.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Alex, I know you haven't spoken.
I have a few a comment really. Have you had a chance to tour some of the elementary schools in La Crosse?
Mm-hmm.
All right. I think there might be one that's not, but I think every single one of them is on the SAGE program. And that's really something that's keeping those schools alive. It keeps the class sizes low because with lower, that's going to sound mean. Sometimes with lower income families or lower income neighborhoods, the value of education isn't always at home. And to really succeed at education, you need to have it at home. And so keeping those class sizes small really helps push that through.
And I don't know of many people that would say that SAGE has not been a huge success.
But I don't think there's a real...
But we still have to be able to put our money where our mouth is. We can't just say it's a great program, but let it die on the vine.
Yeah. And then I had a comment on... Now, you mentioned earlier people treating your position or the positions they've been granted as a job, per se, being paid, you know, a salary that would be deemed able to live on. Where is the movement to say that's not right? Because in my opinion, in my very idealist opinion that they teach us in government class, it isn't. It's an honor to go and serve your country, serve your state, as, you know, Cincinnatus, the style that he taught us, and then to put down that power and come back and pick up the plowshare. You know, just the idea that, you know, you shouldn't treat this as a job. You should treat this as, you know, you're a servant to the people. You know, and we talk about Nebraska, for example. Their state they just have one house, unicameral. They're nonpartisan. You know, that's something that's fantastic. And their state senators are paid $13,000 a year. They have term limits, and so people aren't attracted to it for the bribes they can take. They're attracted to it because they don't go into a room where they're a Republican or a Democrat. They go into a room where they're Nebraskans representing their state. Where is that movement in our state to bring it back home a little bit? Because I don't think there's a single person out there that says our politicians should be paid more. I think, you know, if you asked anyone, they'd say they should be paid a lot less.
With you there. You know, if he wants to teach a class, he'd be okay without teaching.
Well, I was honestly thinking that. I delivered papers as a boy. Does that qualify me to teach English?
That's a good point. To answer your question about the pay for legislators, there's kind of arguments both ways.
Mm-hmm.
In the state where you pay really low salaries, mm-hmm. then the only people that can afford to run for those positions are the very wealthy,
mm-hmm.
Because they don't need the money. The person who has a family to support can't afford to do that particular job. So you're skewing the legislature, like the U.S. Congress and the U.S. Senate, to be a place full of rich people.
Mm-hmm.
And so you don't necessarily get that understanding of the travails of the, I'm going to use big words too since you're using good ones, the travails of the average working person. Mm-hmm. And so I'd be concerned with having it too low. Too high, you're right, it's very much an incentive to do everything you can, even if it means selling your soul, to keep that position. And it brings in not just wealthy, but unwealthy people who are really in it for the money. Mm-hmm. And if you're in it for the money, that's the wrong reason. So there's got to be a medium, a happy medium in there. When I ran for the first time, I made it clear that I believed in that concept of citizen legislators, and I was not going to make this a full-time job. And I would continue to practice law because that contact with my clients, who are people in many situations who are struggling with things that you know, are common problems that it's easy to ignore if we're removed from dealing with them day after day. And, mm-hmm. I found that to be really important to me. But the majority of my colleagues in the legislature consider it a full-time job. I think that is a mistake. I think that we need to look at it as, to some extent, a labor of love. It has to be enough that you can, you know, survive on it. But I think that you should have another job. Mm-hmm. In addition to that. But that's kind of like, you know, asking people to cut their own pay. That's not an easy thing to do, or to give up power. So the honest answer to your question, Alex, is that I'm not seeing a movement in the legislature. I mean, I've said it on a number of occasions that I don't think it should be a full-time job, and I think that it gets paid too much as it is. But I'm not finding people that are willing to pick up that ball and run with it. You know, at some point, things may get dysfunctional enough that something has to give. And let me turn it to another area where I think that something has to change. Back in the 80s, I worked in the state legislature, mm-hmm. and for a state senator from Kenosha, who was a great guy. He was a Democrat, and his closest ally in government was Tommy Thompson, the Republican governor. I had close friends in both parties. We socialized with people in both parties. There were bipartisan softball leagues and so forth. And then we had this ethics issue that came up where people were inappropriately using state dollars to run campaigns and so forth. And we changed the law, and I think that we probably went overboard. Let me give you an example of that. When I was there, our favorite thing to do was usually like on a Wednesday night, one of the different organizations, whether it was you know, some business group or a chamber of commerce or a union or even the county's association, would sponsor a reception. Everybody would show up because they had great food and free beer, and you'd be there and you'd be rubbing elbows with people of the opposite party, and you'd get to know them and their kids and their family. And the next day, when you're on the floor of the assembly or the Senate, you couldn't just look over at them and attack them as an entity because you knew that person. Well, we changed the law to say that now you can't accept anything beyond nominal value, which is like the value of a pen. I can't even accept a cup of coffee from somebody without paying for it. And so what happens is, legislators being cheap, they tend not to go to those events anymore. So a lot of my members I see in our caucus when we have our meetings, but a lot of the Republicans that have been there as long as I have, I've never talked to them. I mean, I may see them in my committee if they're in my committee, but a lot of them aren't. So I have no idea who they are, and they have no idea who I am. It's a lot easier to demonize somebody that you don't know, mm-hmm. than it is somebody that you do know. And that's, I think, a big part of this lack of civility and this huge gap, this lack of bipartisanship, because we just don't care about them. I mean, if we rip on them and tear them down, it doesn't mean anything to us because we don't know them as a person. So we need to make this where people are more anxious to serve because it's the right thing to do, and we need to make it so that they are willing to serve with people of both parties so that there is more respect. I mean, those two things, I think, would be the biggest change that we could have in our state government. And I'd like to say that I see some light on the horizon. I'm not sure I do, to be honest. I mean, I don't want to be too much of a downer, but I am a little concerned that it's, you know, it's going to have to get darker before the dawn comes.
Now, I've heard it said from a teacher that our state politics have reached a level of corruption that has been unmatched since the Gilded Age.
Yeah, you know, here's an interesting story with a local twist to it. When I was working in the legislature, there was a reporter from the La Crosse Tribune by the name of Grant Bloom. Grant is still around. I see him every once in a while. He was an investigative reporter, and he came up with this project. Back in those days, the state telephone system, you know, we didn't have cell phones and stuff, so to make long-distance phone calls from our office in Madison, we'd have to go on this Centrix line, or I can't remember exactly what it was called. And, you know, the state would pay for those long-distance phone calls for us to make. And there was an investigation by Grant looking at, well, who are state officials calling? You know, what, you know, are these all legitimate calls, or are they making personal calls on the state dime? There was a state representative by the name of Joe Luby from Eau Claire, who was very popular in his district, always reelected very comfortably. Grant Bloom discovered that Joe had made about a half a dozen phone calls to his daughter down in Kansas or Nebraska. Joe said, you know, she's there for school, but she is my constituent. She had a problem with her driver's license. We weren't talking about family things. I was helping her with her driver's license and that kind of stuff. And the voter said, you liar, Joe. You are screwing the state out of that $5 that you made on those phone calls. You're out of here. And they threw him out of office. You know, that's what Wisconsin used to be like, where we were so pure that we wouldn't even tolerate a couple dollars of you know, bad, you know, ripping off the taxpayers. Now, you know, we're past those days, and money is everything. And, you know, they're talking about, you know, even making more money available in state politics by lifting the donation levels and the expenditure levels and so forth. And, you know, I would hope that we're not as, you know, the most corrupt, you know, since the Gilded Age, but we're certainly more corrupt than we were when I was working there as a staffer. And I don't like the direction that we're going to. And, you know, we have this Government Accountability Board whose job it is to make sure that we have, you know, ethics in government, and we can, you know, keep politics as clean as possible. They're the ones who were part of the John Doe investigation against the governor, and they've made some of the members of the majority party upset about some of the different things that they've done. So guess what's included in the governor's budget? 11 position cuts from the Government Accountability Board. You know, the governor was, one of the criticisms in the audit was that they were too slow in responding to concerns about perhaps people voting twice and so forth. And they said, well, we had all these recalls and this other stuff that we were dealing with. We didn't have a chance to get, you know, to that. So what's the solution? Cut 11 positions from the agency. I mean, you know, that's the direction that we're going. I mean, it doesn't make any sense.
Any other questions? I know we are past what we had planned for this evening. So anything related directly to school district?
It was about the 48% cut to the Secretary of State position.
Why don't we just take that offline and have a discussion with him and try to keep things...
Thank you, guys. I really appreciate the invitation.
Well, I have a couple comments.
Sure.
Really quick. I promise to make this brief, though. Steve, for your information, I don't know if you realize this, even though we've been told that K-12 funding is flat, our school district is anticipating about a $904,000 cut if it moves forward at this rate. I would suggest, you know, you made the recommendation that we tell our story, and we have told our stories. I feel like what's happening is that the people in the legislature feel like they're all experts in education because they've all gone to school. Not all of them have finished, but they've all been in elementary school or high school, and some in higher ed, but they're all experts in it. And I would challenge them to get out into the schools to see what's going on. Our people... Don't stop educating students. They're educating students, you know, 12 hours a day, whether it's in the classroom or doing work outside of the classroom. So I would really encourage them. And as Alex said, get into those elementary schools and see the difference when you've got 30 students in an elementary classroom versus 20 students or 15, and what a difference that can make.
Well, you know, somebody the other day had a really great counter to the idea that teachers University teachers should teach more class or work longer hours. They noted that last year the state senate was in session 7 days.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
But they got paid for the whole year.
Exactly. And the final thing I would say is you mentioned that we were so accepting of the Senate bill versus the Assembly bill, and it's, I would say it just stinks less. That's what I would say. It just, you know, we have been pounded and pounded and pounded, and so what are we going to say? We know that who has the majority in Madison. And so I do think the Senate bill came out of some of the listening to what those concerns were in Assembly Bill 1. But it, you know, it's not a good bill. I don't think it's a good direction for us, but it, you know, it stinks a little less.
No, I'm glad you mentioned that. I didn't have anybody write to me saying, this is a wonderful bill, why don't you even co-sponsor it? I mean, they said, it's a heck of a lot better than the Assembly version. At least it gives us something to build on.
Yeah, because our work every day, if we stop doing our work, that's going to impact a child, many children. And so we don't do that. We don't have people, you know, we have the WASB connection, but we don't have, our district doesn't have someone in Madison lobbying for us to let you know what's going on. So we do appreciate your coming out on times like this so you can hear our wide variety of concerns and passion, as you've mentioned. And so we do really appreciate your time.
I will come anytime that you want me to come. I enjoy this. This is, you know, kids are really why I do this job, because that, you know, our next generation is who's going to pay for our nursing home, basically.
Well, and we had a good civics lesson tonight, so thank you very much.
Well, and thank you folks for all you do. You have what is a lot of times an even more thankless job than I have, and you get paid a lot less, so thank you so much.
You bet.
Good night.
Thank you. Good night, Steve. Thanks. So then we'll move on with reports and discussion. District Administrator search process update. I know we're doing some things with some teleconferencing.
I think Ms. Kovacs is going to get us on, and perhaps Mr. Clark.
I know in your packets there are information responses or the compilation of the survey. Some of the brochure, the draft brochure that's going to be used. That's okay.
What is that?
How old is this, Christina? Can you hear me?
We look fine. Rick and I are just in here waiting for you both.
Sorry, we got a little delayed in our first presentation, but we are eager to hear from you.
Wonderful. Well, we've just been chatting away, so we're just more than happy to patiently wait here, but we're very ready. So, Vic, is going to take it away when you folks are ready. Can you see a screen there?
We can now, yes.
Good. Wonderful. Good. Well, we want this to be your meeting as well as our meeting, and we just want to give you a quick overview report, and we're really excited about being a part of your process and look forward to a great success in achieving your goals. And so you all might just quickly go through a little bit that was done in terms of putting together this document that we'll be using all the more to advertise during the next 30 days. It would also be on your website and also can be distributed in paper if desired. So we'll give you a little overview and then give them a lot of opportunity for questioning. So okay. I'll go ahead.
Okay.
Good, thank you. And you have, go ahead. In North Platte tonight, and I'm in Lincoln.
Oh.
Okay. North Platte's about a 3-hour drive west of Lincoln. So, well, as we get started here tonight, I'm assuming you have in front of you a paper copy of the brochure. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. Well, what we did, as you're aware, we came in and spent a day on the 27th and the evening of the 26th, and just listen to
lots of folks that came into those public meetings that we're holding, as well as you're aware, Vic has a chance to sit with and interview with board members, some in person, some by phone. And we took the verbal information, we just took very, very careful notes about in-person meetings, and then looked at the survey responses that people are getting, which is essentially the same information, just more specifically ranked and rated. So we're asking much of the same questions in person as we were on the survey, but that's where we get two different kinds of feedback from folks, describing how they describe Holmen as a community, whether they're a school district, and the leader most needed. And we took all of that information from what Vic was gathering, or I was gathering, the chattering that consists of how we define areas of commonality, and came up with a brochure. The pictures that we have in the brochure were originally provided from the district. And you'll notice you have the Holmen High School, because we know that there's a certain degree of pride in your facility. And it also brings you a conversation about what a great place Holmen is to live in the whole area, Marcos area, or the outdoors. So just a little bit of a flavor of the cover as we move to the inside of the brochure. Again, that whole sense of what are we about and what's important to us, and the pictures in the top, and then down below just describing the opportunity and the community. The actual description is a modified version of what came from the Holmen city website, and as we looked at that, it was being described very consistently with what people were telling us. And we thought, well, what better way to have the description than, you know, from somebody local. We did add a few things in there that were consistent with the conversations people had with us, but primarily trying to give a really nice impression of the community. And then, of course, the website for people to access more information. And then on the first page, on the inside-facing page, just describing the context, describing the board, the district, again, highlighting things that people are highlighting, so just a few facts and figures, to make it easier, and then also looking at, students, facilities, employees, finances, community commitment. We took some items from facts and figures from the district, from the report card that the state gives you, and just tried to paint a little picture of the context of Holmen as a district. And of course, for more information, give you the district website here. And it's always nice to give them a context in terms of, well, what is the vision and mission of the district? This was right from the district website. So we've entitled it something that we've heard a lot of, and that is the culture of continuous improvement. So we put that in context there as well. And then finally, the most important part of the brochure is taking all that feedback, both verbally, in person, from very, very careful listening and notes, as well as taking what we were gathering from the survey and saying, what are the most common qualifications people are describing as the leader most needed from this point forward, or to the next 5 years or beyond? What kind of things highlight here? So Vic, why don't you highlight these points here?
And I'll be glad to do that, because this is the most important. What we are hearing, and we can read through some of those in detail if you want to, but the first thing we are hearing a lot is we want a very strong communicator, one who will be out communicating within the district as well as out in the community, and working strongly with multiple publics in that communication, but also that authentic interactions with individuals, the various publics, as we're stating, and differences of viewpoint as being as opportunities for even more effective two-way communication. So a strong communicator. The second thing we were hearing really loud and clear was that they want a servant, the people want a servant leader he has humility, that they're looking forward to the opportunity to providing that leadership, that they're emphatic about key indicators in the district that will be based upon what's best for instance, what's best for students. We heard a lot of focuses. The bottom line has to constantly come back to how's this going to benefit kids? How is this going to be different? And how can that servant leader ultimately move in that direction? And in order to do that, they're saying we want somebody that's collaborative with us and will listen and take a lot of input. And, leader needs to know when to take action and move in a decisive direction. And in that process, to be very visionary, so that's a visionary planner that can quickly develop an understanding of the district of where people want to go and where it will be benefiting the kids the most. And then we also heard a lot of focus upon we want somebody that's a real educational leader and an adult talent developer. We want a person who will bring out the very, very best in the people that they immediately surround, bring out the very best in the board, bring out the very best in office staff, et cetera, so you have that growing community where people are thinking, flowing, moving. And then that whole educational leader within the entire district where they're the primary advocate for education within the community, within the school district, et cetera. And then, of course, the bottom line is that you've got to do all this within an accountable direction that you're maximizing human, the physical, and the financial resources. And so that was very, very much. And we'll come back to that in a few moments, but needless to say, every state has their own district certification requirements. Many of them are ridiculous, but they're still there. Saying we'll cut off funding to you, we'll do anything if you don't have a superintendent that has the proper licensure. And so basically that's an absolute requirement. And then salary, we try to keep more open. And my own personal view is, and it seems to be represented a little bit there, with you folks, it would be nice to have at least part of the salary having some performance indicators to it, so that the person would be rewarded for results and not just activity. But so we kept that kind of open, and then of course we mentioned that we're starting to screen right now as applicants come in. We have 12 of them right now, but most people that in my best judgment, we talk about applicants and recruits, and it's sort of like in an athletic field, you have your walk-ons and then you have your recruits. So we're trying to get as many recruits as we can, so not just people that are just coming gravitating toward you, and we've already made a lot of calls in that direction. So we'll be doing that during this entire month, up to March 10th. Then on May 11th,
May 3rd.
I'm sorry?
Yeah, May 1st.
Yeah, but May, yeah, I'm sorry, May 1st. That's a kind of a final date that hopefully we can get, depending upon how things go along, that can happen before that time. And then we tried to be a little bit open in terms of exactly when that person arrives. Ideally, that would be no later than August 1. But if we keep that a little bit fluid, then we can work within the realities that maybe they start July 1, or maybe they start, August 10th or something. But ideally, of course, the summer. And then, of course, we have how to apply and how to move ahead. So But that's kind of what we've done in terms of a quick summary of what's happening. So I think we've been doing lots of talking and not much listening yet. So if you want to start with any questions on the back page, or if you want to start with any questions on any other aspects of the brochure, we're ready to field them.
Well, Vic, maybe you could explain how you'll be using the brochure.
Paul, help me with that. I guess I didn't hear that real clear.
Your question is, how do we intend to use the brochure?
Yes. Will you be mailing it to those prospects, or will you be...
Yes. Paul can have some input on this, and you folks in the district can. One is that we really would like to have that on the school district website for a period of time. Another is that we want it to be sent out to people that we have on our list, this is our client list, et cetera, to inform them about it. So a lot of superintendents that will say, we really want you to recommend somebody that might be interested. And then we encourage you within the district to get out as much as you feel is necessary. And then we don't know the exact way the website works for the Wisconsin School Administrators Association. But if we can put it on that, we'd like to do that, plus possibly Minnesota, Iowa, Illinois. And I usually try to get it publicized quite a bit to the Administrative Association in the immediate surrounding states.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions?
I got a question.
It did, Vic, thank you.
Hey, Vic, it's Tom. Thanks for your time tonight. Can you hear me? Can you hear me all right?
I'm sorry, I missed something.
Can you hear me all right?
That's Tom
who's
talking, Vic.
Yes, Tom.
Okay. On all your qualifications, I know some of these nouns, maybe they go over different areas, but I would say any administrator we get, I'm curious on your feedback for sure, is how would they apply the word creativity? We need a creative superintendent. We live in a creative environment politically. We need creativity 101. What do you think of that? Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's a servant leadership type of approach is where it's at, and the teachers definitely are the most creative ones that we get our answers from. But I would like to know what their answer is. What would their answer be to a question of creativity, and how would it apply to a school 5 years from now, 10 years from now? How do they envision the school district of Holmen as a creative asset to the community? That's really huge.
Therefore, we don't want to continue to keep improving it or giving greater diversity or incorporating more of alternative ways in which kids learn. I think that's kind of what you're getting at, isn't it, Tom?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Vic. Exactly. Thank you.
Yeah. And
just listening to you guys a little more, maybe that would actually weave more effectively the visionary planner. Do you think?
In some ways, Paul, I think that's true.
Okay. I have it marked.
Yeah. It's so vital, and you know, I don't know what you were dealing with tonight now, but there's so many ideas floating around about how education needs to be improved for individuals as well as all kids, and there are some great ideas out there, and there are some great ways in which that's happening, but educators
a lot more hesitant to
apply some of those
things.
So nice to be shaken up a bit on that. But that visionary planner, I
think
Paul's a good place to put it. Okay.
Now, I'm the student representative. My name's Alex. My grandparents actually live in Nebraska. They live down in Hastings. I had a question. I've looked this over. Nothing really stands out to me that something about energetic or youthful. You know, when I think of someone that's going to be leading us, I want somebody that has the energy to be here 30, 40, 55 years. Someone that's going to commit, you know, their time to this district and give it their all. You know, there's nothing in this thing that stands out and says, you know, we want somebody who's bouncing off the walls.
Okay, I'm going to miss servant leader. Second sentence, this person must recognize the challenging nature of leadership and education and be highly committed to investing the mental, emotional, and physical energy required.
See, I read that. I read it and I took it as they recognize the energy. Well, I can focus and see somebody that's really energetic, but it's not saying to me that this job demands, I mean, energy, you know, we want somebody that's energetic. That's the second line, second, third, fourth line. It's kind of buried in that paragraph. I think there should be an emphasis on we want somebody youthful, someone, you know, ready to go.
I don't think we can.
I know that's illegal, but we could try.
We can make that stronger statement.
Yes, that's a stronger statement. Somebody, you know, who has their boots on, ready to land.
Yeah, and I know superintendents that are able to, shall we say, do what you're talking about, make a profound impact upon the total community and the total school district, and that dynamic, creative, resourceful leader that also, you know, it's basically, shall we say, a 24-hour job, and these people are willing to spend 70, 80 hours a week out there working with various publics and interacting in a really dynamic way, and that's, I think that's the type of thing you're looking for. Is that accurate?
Yes.
Anything else?
And then this is just kind of, these characteristics are just kind of a quick overview, but, you know, as we listen and start to screen and listen to these people, that more comprehensiveness can will come out more, too, as we help to begin to sort that out.
Kate, you had a question, or?
Just following up on what Alex was talking about, I think the word maybe that I'd add to what you're talking about is charismatic.
Exactly.
Which, you know, I'm 65, and you know I'm charismatic, so it doesn't need to
well,
be.
Well, yeah, and you know.
I'm teasing you. but just that, and I don't know if that's in that qualification or not. When you mention a person that needs to be invested in the mental, emotional, and physical energy, Alex, I think, is asking for something more than that. And I think some of us who spoke to you felt the same way. It's like, I think I used something like, and this, I was going to say it's kind of a gender-oriented thing, but it isn't in college. It's like a cheerleader. It's somebody who can pump up the crowd.
Yeah.
And so I guess that is something I see lacking here in qualifications, but that's something that's really important to me as well.
Yeah, I heard a fair amount of that in the small group, that desire to have someone who can pump up the crowd. I put a little bit of that into visionary planner. Last sentence of visionary planner: this leader must inspire others with the vision and will articulate its values at the school and the community. That I can see where that could be said much more forcefully.
And Terrence, the word that I heard that it makes some sense. Hey, if it does to you all.
Yep.
Yes, definitely. I think so.
Anybody else?
We'll leave that in.
I think one thing that we talked about, Vic, this is Cheryl, is experienced. You know, I don't know if that needs to be in this description, but we were talking about someone with some district administrator experience, possibly, that was desired, but not. So that would be the only thing I think up front we wanted to.
An interesting topic that comes up with the experience, and beyond some of the basic qualifications that are essential for certification, what we're finding is that sometimes experience, it can be a hindrance. Mm-hmm. in terms of the creativity and so on. Some of our very best superintendents, for example, that the boards have chosen over the years have been people who've been high school principals.
Mm-hmm.
Who really have had to be in the trenches and deal with it day and night and still have that energy and everything that holds them up. So, but ultimately, if you say this person must be a current superintendent of schools, and or the equivalent, we're your servant.
Yeah, I don't think
that's an absolutely essential. Well, then we got to work within that framework.
I don't think it was absolutely, and I think, like an associate or an assistant, a district administrator from a larger district would be maybe desirable or that kind of thing, but I don't know. What's the rest of the board feel?
I wouldn't say that would be the only thing. It's definitely a consideration, but I think I like the idea of having someone who is in the trenches. Like we all want a Marine to come in here. I'm just kidding. But no, someone with recent experience, I think is a good idea too. Someone that in the trenches. So
what about over here? Yay, nay, it's not important.
If you look back to your own history, for example, Fred Frick came to your district as a high school principal.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not
Dale
necessarily uncommon in superintendent leadership. But I'm not saying that you need to, adhere to any of those kind of guidelines or any of those past experiences.
Okay, I mixed reaction from the board, so maybe it's not something we publicize, but just internalize.
Yeah.
Kate?
I know that we've talked about a couple of things. One was that we didn't want to have to train somebody, that we, because we are that kind of district. We have enough kids. We want somebody who has experience. And I do embrace that, but I also embrace the fact that there might be somebody that's phenomenal out there who's not a superintendent yet.
Right.
And so I...
Well, and that's why desirable but not required.
Exactly.
Desired but not required.
No.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I think if board members have other additional thoughts they would like to send off, certainly they could work through Melissa. and provide input that way to Paul and Vic. But we do appreciate your sharing this information with us and with the community. As a, it's a public meeting, so we do appreciate that you're sharing this information with the public. It's important because it is a community, I think, as you've summarized here, that they really see the value of the district and the community, and so I thank you.
And you know, the good news is that the next time, and I want you to feel, any of you to feel free to contact Paul or I directly, but we'll work, you know, predominantly through Cheryl when it comes to key decision makers, since you're the president. But I like the whole idea, of course, that you want to have all the more life and charismatic and visionary kind of attitudes and behaviors there.
Yep.
As I totally agree with that, and as we search this out, we'll do our best to see what we can surface.
Okay. And Tom does have one additional question.
Just your meeting that you just concluded, was that a person that represents you at the state level?
Yes.
Yeah. Now.
And he's still here.
Careful what you say.
That probably this is one of the most difficult times for school leaders to try to balance all the pressures of the national initiatives, the state initiatives, the local initiatives. And so what we find is more and more people are saying, I don't need that job.
Yeah.
Sure.
I don't need all of those pressures coming at me from every which direction. And so it seems to me that we could put in here more, Paul, the that person must be willing and able to take on multiple dimensions of issues and work through them in terms of what's best for kids. It really creates a more difficult challenge for us, no, and for you folks, because it's almost impossible to satisfy the various publics that they represent.
I know you work in many different states. I was just curious, off the top of your head, completely unready for an answer, but how many female versus male superintendents do you have in Wisconsin do you work with? Is there any percentage you have? Do you know anything like that?
Well, I need a little help here because my receiver reception isn't quite right.
You think over the years?
I'm just curious. I'm just wondering. I'm new on the board. I'm just wondering percentage in Wisconsin. Is it more females or males, or is it 50-50 as far as superintendents of school districts?
This has changed a little bit. When I first started doing searches, there was no way that you could even give any consideration to a woman being a superintendent. And if the person was over 55 years old, They were in the water, so that person needed to be, 40 to 55 max. But don't ever consider a woman. And then, as years went by, there have been more and more women. But I say it's still, if you look at across the state of Wisconsin, I would doubt if any school districts in your state that are approximately your size, 4,000 or above, I doubt if there's more than 15 or 20% women.
Okay, I was just curious. Thank you.
And part of the reason that I've found over the years, and I'm a tremendous advocate for talent, regardless of, any of those factors. But women tend to be less likely to want to disrupt the careers of their spouse than men are.
Okay.
So it's one of the challenges we have.
Okay.
They have a great, great woman leader, but they seem to be willing to follow the business tradition, the career paths of their spouses a little bit more than the spouse following the career path of the woman. the wife.
Well, it'll be interesting to see how, if you get to the generations that are coming now.
It's gradually changing. But that's kind of where it's been historically.
All right. Thank you so much. Great insight, as usual.
Quick question before we tap out here. As you look at making a few modifications here to make a few statements stronger, to include creativity, be more bold and forceful about charismatic, we'd like to get this going as quickly as possible so that we can get this advertised, because we have a lot of people we want to send this to in our recruiting effort, as well as the people that you've given us names to recruit. By the way, we have four names of board members already. I contacted two. One was thank you, but no thank you. The other one is, well, I'll think about it. The other two are still working on getting a hold of. But we want to get this out as quickly as possible. So if I do make some of these changes, who is the person who can give the final blessing for us to call it final and start contributing? Would that be Cheryl or
whom? Sure. I would be happy to do it. Probably what I'll do is if you send out a copy to me, I would
that's
send it.
I'm behind in this, getting this out, because the superintendents begin to make, and top level leaders tend to be making decisions for the next year in their own district. Quite a bit. So the faster we can move on this, the better it is.
Sure. So send it to me, and you have to at least give me one or 2 days to take a look at it. So if
it's Monday now, we just say we'll do a glance at this by Wednesday. Does that sound okay?
If you send it to me tomorrow, I'll have it back to you by Wednesday, by the end of business, close of business. Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
All right, I think we need to move on. Thank you very much. We really appreciate it, Paul and Vic, and take care.
Well, thank you very much. Appreciate your hospitality.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Ooh. Okay, then moving on to summer school. Been an interesting evening so far, hasn't it?
Oh, yeah, it's very interesting.
Just not our traditional board meeting.
No. Thank goodness.
I believe you have the PowerPoint presentation in your packets. Yeah. So honestly, there's nothing different for elementary summer school. It's status quo. It's same as last year, and same time frame, same type of classes that are being offered. And the one major difference is looking at a couple more early childhood special education teachers. We presently have almost 35 students in the program, and a majority of them do attend summer school. So we need at least 3 teachers for those young children. So
all right, and like Sue said, very little difference in HMS as well. The only difference that we are looking at right now is to add one additional enrichment offering, and even though we would be offering an additional class, that would be at no net increase to staff.
Pretty much status quo for the high school, same classes that have been offered in the past. And once again, there is a minimum class size and there's also a maximum class size. So status quo for HHS for the summer. Any questions?
Any questions?
Just queens and king of summer school. Our district has such a good reputation, and I know how much work it takes to pull summer school together, and you made the report very concise and very, and we appreciate that, of course, but behind the scene, hours and hours of work. So thank you all for what you do to pull together this good reputation that we have for summer school.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, within school district choice request, Julie.
And I am Julie this evening.
Oh, I was going to say.
In your packet, you have a issue paper that also appears on the consent this evening. I was comfortable coming with you, even though this is the first presentation on this. We are approving. We had a total, I believe, of 4 requests. And this, again, is for our resident parents in our school district who live in an attendance area, but they wish to have their child, this isn't at the elementary level, to attend one of the other elementary schools. This is what this is put in place for. And so through the process, Ms. Krakow manages this, and she forwarded her recommendation to me. We reviewed it. And so that's our recommendation to you to approve those requests that have come in. And we put this on the agenda, on consent also for you, so that if approved, then we will go ahead and move forward soon and contact those families.
Hey.
Thanks, Julie.
Okay, then next on the agenda is preliminary budget update, Dr. Carlson.
Thank you. This evening, Mr. Clark and I are going to trade off. First of all, in your board packet, you have a couple different items related to this agenda item. You have the narrative that I put out to you, the budget memo narrative. Associated that to that directly is what is already on the screen. We refer to it as the budget memo spreadsheet. And then we have another document that we'll be sharing with you, more the format, the DPI format of the budget that we have utilized in the past. So with that, we're going to just use the spreadsheet right now to walk us through a little bit of what information we want to share with you. Before I turn it over to Jay to get us started on the revenue and sources, I do want to share with you that when we are finished presenting what we have prepared in a matter of several weeks, and this is what was included in your packet, we'll have some additional comments at the end related to the governor's budget proposal and kind of our projections at this point of how that may impact this process. And I just want to make sure that the board knows that we will be interested in direction for even as early as the next board meeting on February 23rd, where we would typically come to you and ask you to approve the preliminary budget, looking for some direction when the night is done on what that might look like, considering where the state is at as far as the governor's proposal. So we want to share with you, though, the work that's been done up to this point. Okay? So I'm going to have Jay begin.
Dr. Carlson and I had a brief conversation earlier this week that this might be an advantage that we actually prepared this document before the state budget information came. So you would have a context of what would it have been like had things to measure what the impact is of what happened at the state level. Or I guess we don't know exactly what's going to happen at the state level. But as of tonight, I understand that 90% of that's likely to happen. So. The first section deals with the revenue sources, local sources, and state sources first. And you can see the combination of those two represents slightly over $1 million. Those two being the local and state sources, local sources being the tax increase, about $437,000 of that $441,000 is estimated to be local property tax increase for the general fund. The state increase you see there was based upon a projection of what would happen with the state equalized aid increases received by the district. You should note that the revenue limit increase as well as the equalized aid increase is largely driven by our enrollment increase. We are an increasing enrollment school district. Included in those numbers, you should also know, was $75 per pupil increase in revenue limit and $150 continuing per pupil funding in special categorical aid. And those may become important numbers for you to remember as we move forward. On the third item listed there, open enrollment tuition revenue, I would say this is a moving target. We don't know what people will elect in terms of open enrollment choices. This is an early estimate. You'll note later on we talk about open enrollment dollars out or expenditures, and you see the ones coming in being higher. You might think, oh, this is a demonstration that more are electing us than are leaving us, or an anticipation that would happen. The reason for the difference is really the nature of the students that come to us. You heard tonight in the brochures, and I think it's widely known in our community, we do a great job of serving students with special needs. And one child with special needs open enrolling in doesn't represent the same dollar amount as the non-special needs student moving out. More dollars flow with special needs students, and that's the cause for the difference here. Again, this is an early estimate, and that number for sure will change. But it's a starting point in terms of budget planning. So you can see a little bit, $1.1 million in increased revenue anticipated next year. I'm going to cover some of the first items under new costs and then turn it over to Dr. Carlson to continue. But the salaries and benefits, largest portion of our budget increase, includes such things as health insurance increasing at 5%. That was one of the budget input variables. Dental insurance at 2.5%. Salaries increasing at 2%. It includes the attrition of some retiring teaching staff members and the replacement with teaching staff members. It includes benefits related to salaries, such as the Wisconsin Retirement System contributions increasing at the same 2% that staff salaries are anticipated to increase.
Flat budget or a more accurate budget? I know there's a hesitancy to do that because of that flexibility, but.
We've made a lot of progress, and I would have to say the last 3 years, going back when with Mr. Austin was here, we spent a lot of time examining closely. When you look at, is this kind of a blip on the radar? Is this recurring versus non-recurring? Should we anticipate this? What was the reason? So we've spent a great deal of time in doing just that. I think that because of that, we've been able to narrow and close that gap a little bit over time and really make use of those resources as they are intended. But that doesn't mean still the last 2 years or so, again, when it's all said and done at the end of the year, those expenses have been less.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Okay, and then comments.
I don't have an additional visual because it's fairly simple of what we're just going to share with you this evening. As I think Jay or others had alluded to, in the input variables, including the preliminary budget figures that you're presented with tonight, you already had approved building in some input variables and around revenue. And two things. There's a per pupil adjustment for revenue limits, and then a per pupil categorical aid. Now, Mrs. Hancock, earlier this evening, when Representative Doyle was here, made a comment about $900,000. And so the per pupil adjustment, that is being recommended to be frozen. In other words, we've operated last year or two at least of a $75 increase in that amount. We built that in to that preliminary budget, that $75 per pupil amount. Right now it's being in that proposed budget zero. What does that mean? That means about $301,000 for that item. Second would be the per pupil categorical aid. That's what's gotten a lot of attention as well, the $150 per student for this year. And then the second year of the biennial budget, they are recommending $165 then added. So you can balance that out. But our concern right now is the 2015-16 budget. And right now we had built in the $150. We had that confirmed by our help from PMA. And so that in the governor's budget would be zero for next year. That's where that additional $603,000 comes from. So it's those two figures, those two input variables that at this point, given the less than a week where we're at right now and digesting all of that. And still more work. And Representative Doyle mentioned that is too. We'll wait and see. And so, but tonight, we wanted to at least share with you that information. You can, so if you're talking approximately $900,000, and what we just presented to you, you can see the challenge that we have. We aren't at the point of presenting any real recommendations at this point, looking for some direction. Again, to keep schedule of our budget planning process, we had hoped to bring a recommendation to you tonight as far as presenting, and then coming to you on February 23rd for approval. With this new information, perhaps some guidance, direction on what you would like us to work on in the coming weeks. For example, on the 23rd, the next time we come back together, would you want at this time the governor's budget proposal reflected in our preliminary budget? And that would be a question. If you want that reflected in there, then for February 23rd, do you want us to not only incorporate that in, but what we come back to you with is to achieve as close to a balanced preliminary budget as possible. So it's two different things that we are perhaps looking for some direction from you tonight, if possible. And if this may, you may decide to, it may just result in a delay by a board meeting or so to allow us to do some continued work on this.
Well, this seems to come up every 2 years, you know, every time we have the budget. And could you just share with us what we have done in the past? Because it seems that we have, I guess, responded to these kind of issues in the past.
Well, perhaps 2 years ago, again, this last biennial budget had come back to add or to include, I'll say increases, but it was things that the prior biennial budget had not included. So if you go back far enough, perhaps this biennial budget that we are currently in, we did not necessarily, Mrs. Hancock, have to deal with that as much 2 years ago.
I thought early on, though. It seems to me that early on, as they were doing budget deliberation, that there was a question, and we just went with our...
And that would be part of our caution tonight. I think that there is some already indication, although Mr. Doyle would know better than anybody, some indication that maybe there might be some changes, might be some room for changes. So it's a fair question. What have we done in the past? I think we've done a little bit of both. We've kind of paid attention to what is going on. We've started to do some preliminary planning. We haven't necessarily pushed the panic button right away, but we need to be thoughtful and really pay attention to what's happening. It's been a few years, but we've had years in the past where this preliminary budget that we come to you tonight with, in the past, it's shown quite a deficit, a planned deficit, and then we know we have work to do. And by the time we get to the proposed in August, and surely in October, we've done some work, whether that's some reductions, whatever the case may be. That's been a while since we've really had to do that. Certainly not the last biennial budget.
So what would be the pleasure of the board? Tim?
What is statutorily required with a preliminary budget for a school board? Is there a timeline? Do we have to?
I'd have to go back and look, Mr. Mettinger.
The reason why I ask, and first before I explain, I want to thank Representative Doyle for staying this late. I mean, I know you had a meeting very early at 7 o'clock this morning, so really appreciate you staying to hear some of this conversation. But my concern is obviously, I think the goings-on at the state have the potential to very much negatively impact the school district. And if we were to take action on this preliminary budget as it stands at our next meeting, it could unintendedly give an impression that, hey, everything's okay and it's not as bad as it looks while this debate is going on. And so I obviously would not want to send that message, because we know that, or at least we have reason to believe, more than just a speculation, that now some of these input variables are not going to be what we anticipated. And so my preference would be to, if we could, just delay till we get maybe a better degree of confidence or looked at some other factors. Because obviously I would hate to give the impression that, yep, it's okay and I'll look at the Holmen School District's budget is fine and they're all in good shape, when that is based on information that we have reason to believe is not going to be accurate. And that would just be my caution.
I see some heads nodding. Kate?
I do too. It's important to me to know what impact, even if it's 90% that's coming down, I have to know the figures and what that means. And so what does $900,000 less than what I was expecting look like? That's pretty big. That's really pretty big. We also have a referendum coming up. That's really pretty big. I know that's added work for you, and I don't know that I need it by next week. I don't know when the budget is going to come slamming down the pike for us and reality will hit.
Well, and I would be afraid, as you said, extra work if they, because as we've seen in the past, we see that initial budget proposal and then it's different. And so if they take the current budget now and adjust it to that, and then we see all this negotiating happening in Madison, and then, well, then we, the workload, you know, I just would hate to see them have to readjust just for every rumor or every nuance that's happening in Madison. And so I think Tim's question is a good one. You know, are we statutorily required to do preliminary budgets? I know, Jay, we're required to have a budget at the annual meeting, right?
Dr. Carlson and I were just conferring, and in terms of a preliminary budget, we're not aware of any statute that says you have to have a preliminary budget. But we have such a cycle of doing it so far in advance. I don't know when the last time I went back and checked what the dates are. So we can.
Feel different, though? It feels different to me this time. This feels like, maybe not, huh? Maybe I should just relax and not. I can't relax with this, but it feels like it's going to happen. So then I want to start thinking about what are we going to do if we do have that much less money.
I was going to say, to me, it does feel different, but it also feels somewhat like 4 years ago.
So are we okay then with just not coming back next meeting with a budget to approve? Certainly a budget update. I think we'd like to keep that on the agenda and have them continue to do that, share with us the
We will work more on that. We all always want to be sensitive. The board's done some great improvements in the past 2 years, if not more, on the budget cycle accelerating it or doing it a little bit early, so to give the board some more time. But quite honestly, this situation may warrant just staying put for at least a board meeting or two. As I look out here, several of our leadership team members, we have not since last week had an opportunity to even meet as a leadership group to really look at this. We plan to get together Wednesday afternoon. This will be on our agenda as well. So we'll continue working on this and keep you abreast of what's happening. And if nothing else changes, hearing that we need to start to definitely reflect this in our budget work. So,
all right. Okay. Thank you. So then I think we are ready to move on to consent agenda. Dr. Carlson, I think he has a couple comments to make before we go there, just a brief one.
Well, yes, and quite honestly, I'm not sure. I believe Mrs. Holmen has had to leave. And so I think some board members had the opportunity, but I was going to ask Jay. Jay's done so much work with the search process, and so I wanted to take this opportunity. I'm still going to ask Jay to say a few comments about our recommendation for the next Administrator for Business Services, and that recommendation is included in your personnel report this evening.
The meeting went a little bit longer than I had anticipated when I invited Julie to be here tonight, so she had to leave early. But Julie Holmen is our recommended candidate for the vacant Administrator Business Services. She's currently in the La Crescent school system as the Administrator Business Services and has been for 8 years. And she's a lifelong La Crescent resident, and we're really excited to have her. And it's a rather rigorous interviewing process, and we took our time. I think we've got, I know we have the right person.
Okay, thank you. So with that, we have five items under the consent agenda. I would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda items as submitted, unless a board member wants to pull one out.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, a motion's been made and seconded to approve the consent agenda items as presented. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion passes. Board members' reports and discussion. I'll call on board members under roll call order and ask you present any comments or committee reports that you have. Mr. Dunlap.
Well, I heard a inspiring comment from the FFA, and that was her comment about be honest and fair in the game of life. I thought that was great advice. I think we could all follow that. And I'd also like to thank everyone for supporting the band uniform fundraising. That seems to be going really well, and really seems promising. And as everybody knows, I really love those guys.
In the interest, and girls.
And girls, I'm sorry, yes. In the interest of fair play, and better understanding, perhaps we could bring in a member of the duly elected majority into the boardroom sometime for so we could ask them some questions and get some comments, some clarification on some of the assumptions and half-truths that perhaps can come out of a one-sided conversation.
You want to invite the governor?
That'd be nice. Yeah.
I would just note, we invite the people who are elected, so when Mike Hipps was...
It always seems like it's so one-sided.
Well, Mike Hipps used to come.
I have miles and miles of notes and probably hours of conversation and hours of comments I could make, but I'm not going to. But I think in a sense, a fair play, it would be nice to have someone else in here from the elect majority.
Okay. Mr. Cruz.
I think Gary... Gary makes a good point, so I like that idea too. Have some cross connection and discussions, but it just was a nice energy, long meeting, but it's important. So enthusiasm is always nice to see. Thank you.
Thank you, Alex Ockery.
Well, I have a few things. I'll try and make it brief. First of all, the coffee's pretty warm, so that's good. I think in the future, if we do go over 2 hours, there should be a scheduled coffee break. That's my Norwegian talking. I do have to say, it was last week or the week before, Mr. King traveled down to, I don't know where, for a convention on the farm to school.
Wisconsin Rapids.
And the keynote speaker was Deborah Kane, who, as we all know, is the USDA's National Director of the Farm to School Program. Now, in her speech, she said something along the lines that the way that Holmen is doing their Farm to School Program is the way that the entire country should be doing it. And, you know, I love Holmen, but there's not a lot of time that we're at the cutting edge, that we're the standard for the country and maybe even the world. But in this particular time, it is. So if you've had a chance, we did have a showcase day. If you saw the Holmen Courier, there was some pictures. We fed the entire school district chicken. Beautiful pieces. I got a really big one. I knew the person serving, so I guess that helped.
Winner,
winner, chicken dinner.
Yep, yeah. And it was fantastic. You know, and our school lunches are always good. They do the very best with, you know, the standards that they're given. And I guess it makes me very proud to know that we're at the the front of the pack on that. Not much happened this week. Ooh, I put out a fire today inside the school. I was walking by the microwave, and I'm going to talk about this. This is my proud moment of the day. And I guess somebody just misplaced their welding rod and accidentally left it in the microwave, and it was a little flaming. So I did the right thing that we actually learned freshman year how to do that. So you push clear, and you're supposed to unplug it and open it, let it air out. I didn't unplug it. I just pushed cleared and opened it and then moved it out with my hand. So that's cool. Yeah, so I was very happy that stuff I learned in the school ended up arguably saving the school. So I'm not saying there should be a medal or anything, but, you know, something of where that's at. And, you know, he talked about earlier, Mr. Doyle, oh, he left. you know, 30 years ago, our government was, you know, recalling people or not reelecting people that were misusing $5-6. And there's few states that are doing that now. And I talk a lot about Nebraska, but clearly we trust Nebraska because they're finding our new superintendent. You know, I believe it was there two lieutenant governors ago, 4 or 5 years ago, he resigned over the misuse of a government-supplied cell phone. He was making calls that weren't especially, you know, government-related, and he resigned over that fact. You know, to have a politician in Wisconsin do that would be absurd. And that's very sad to me, but, you know, it's the world that we live in. I thought I had something else. Maybe not. That was shorter than I thought. Okay.
Okay, Alex, thank you. Yep. Anita Jagosinski.
I just would like to say that March 18th is WASB Day at the Capitol, where I went a couple of years ago. School board members from all over the state can go and talk to your legislators or any legislators. I don't feel the need to talk to my legislators much because they come and talk to us, and I think we're on the same page. But to me, this day at the Capitol is even more important than going to the WASB convention for a couple of days to learn about how to be a good school board member. This is the one day that as a voice unified with other board members from around the state, you go to the Capitol and you meet with legislators and you listen to the Joint Finance Committee and you ask questions and you advocate in your role that you are elected to do, which is represent public schools and public school children. And that's the job we have. That's what we were elected to do. So this day is March 18th, day at the Capitol. You can contact Christina to register. It's one day. I can take it off unpaid. I think anyone can. So,
okay. All I have. And Kate Mayer.
Yes, to what Anita just said, I'll be going on that day. I think it's kudos to Evergreen that had a Courier Life article, and maybe Randy, you know this, about children reading to dogs, and that helps them feel comfortable. The kids that, yeah, because dogs don't know if you. Right, yeah, you're nodding. So, yeah, you could read to a dog, even if you're not really fluent. Reading to a dog is really cool. And there's a really cool picture in the paper of Carolyn Green, I want to say, right? That was just awesome. And a little wee one and a pup. So that was cool. And isn't it like, is it school bus driver month?
Week.
I just can't say enough about our school bus drivers. I mean, my kids always, for a couple of years, we're on the farthest route, and so they were the earliest picked up and the last dropped off, and their bond with their school bus driver was incredible. And we have a low turnover rate, it seems like, at least what I experienced. And so just thank you to that whole transportation department and what they do and what the drivers do and get out there every morning in these cold, cold days and get that bus heated up and ready. Appreciate them.
What's special is the driver remembers you. My bus driver I had in kindergarten, his name's Doug, and he works in the building now. But, you know, the first day, I don't know, freshman year, I was walking down the hallway and he,
he waved me over and he said, oh, do you remember me? And, you know, of course I didn't because it was kindergarten, but it slowly came back to me. And he was my bus driver for 1 year, but he could pick me out.
Yeah.
I think it's it takes a special person to do that.
I think so. And the ones that last forever. There was also an article in La Crosse Tribune about a retired bus driver. I'll make this very brief. But for 40 years, and his undertaker, the guy that owned the undertaking business, has designed a coffin for him. You're nodding, right? You saw this. And it looks like a school bus. And he didn't want to hurt his feelings, but the school bus driver was overwhelmed and moved to tears. And so I think some of the guys and women that we have that have been doing this for a year are just like that. It's like that's who they are. So thanks to all of them.
Thank you. Mr. Menninger. Tim.
You know, I think probably only a handful of times have I done this in my years on the board, but I have nothing to add this evening.
Well, I think I'm going to do the same. I really don't have anything to add either. So we'll move on to correspondence received. I think the orange or the red folder was going through. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't have anything to say because I was going to ask Dr. Carlson to do just a brief update on the referendum. As he's getting into place, I would just note the board meeting schedule is there on your agenda. We have Matt Fail will be in on the 17th of February, so please, if you can keep your calendar clean for that evening, that would be great.
Part of Mrs. Hancock's comments, we just talked briefly about referendum, and so I said I'd be happy just to bring attention to our website, and that's my comment for to help her out with her comments. If you go to our website, you'll see on the front page right here 2015 referendum, and so we're just starting to build this. I don't know if it's on the screen in front too, but so if you just click on that, and then you'll come to, this is kind of a beginning of an introduction, and I want to thank Mrs. Kovacs for her help with this. Mr. Clark has helped. Several people have started to help putting some information together. And so then you can just continue on the journey, and you can click there, and it'll take you to kind of that introduction about the referendum, the two questions. Then over here is where we're going to continue to build this site, and it starts out with the brochure, a trifold. I think we put a copy in your board folder. I'll just bring this up quickly for the public. And this is a fact sheet that we just finalized. We've had a working draft. If you go here, you can zoom it in a little bit more. And we're just about ready. If we didn't today, we're about ready to take it to print. And so we'll be having copies made of the fact sheet. So again, it's just two-sided, a trifold. And so that is one area. And I'm just going to now go back out. And so here's this, the items here listed again. And so if you go to community information sessions, we have sessions that we are in the process of setting dates for. I'll bring this to the board members' attention too. Here's some dates for that we're going to be planning some community information sessions where a community can come to us at these locations and dates and times. And this would be something that we might be reaching out to some of you. And how board members' roles and responsibilities or opportunities that they might have helping with these sessions as well. And if you just continue on. You can just work your way down the list, referendum questions, that'll come up, the frequent asked questions, that Q&A document that you know very well. We have that listed there. We have a place to submit your question. And so we have a special email address for people who want to submit questions or comments. And also, if you would like to request, if you are part of an organization or club, if you want to request us to come out and give a presentation. So this is an area that you can communicate with us, or you can pick up the phone and give us a call too. And then finally, just how do I vote? And this is still being worked on and developed. We have more information that we'll be putting on this. Once we get the special newsletters put together, which is the first one we hope to have go out towards the end of next week, we'll put that on the website, and we'll continually be adding to this site as we move forward. So, any questions?
Just a note, too, that the role, I think you alluded to the roles and responsibilities of the school board and the school district. Just a reminder that as a board and as a district, we are there for information purposes only. We provide that information, the facts, those sorts of, that sort of information. So just keep a reminder that if you're asked, you certainly can, as a private citizen, you know, express your own opinion, but as a school board, we are there to provide, in official capacities, only information and facts. So
I can tell you we've started to go out, give some brief presentations to our staff. That'll continue. We have PTO, our parent organizations, lined up at most of our schools. We have some community groups. We have Rotary planned for March 4th already. So it has started and already, and looking forward to the process. Thank you.
Thank you. So then we have two items under board policy for review. The first one is the interscholastic sports and school-sponsored activities and school representative on the board. And I was going to ask about the school representative, because wouldn't that go to personnel and governance, not SALC?
Thank you.
Yeah. That's, yes, but the interscholastic sports and school-sponsored activities, Kate, was there... It didn't appear that there were any major changes. You're just reviewing it, updating it. And then the student representative on the Holmen Board of Education, that does go to personnel and governance because it's governance related. And I know Alex has asked for us to review it. It pertains to the student member being able to make motions or seconds. Their votes are recorded, but they aren't officially counted, I guess, is how
I just think
policy is stated.
Having done a lot of research on it and comparing it to other school districts, ours, for lack of a better term, is kind of pathetic. Just the length of it. You know, it's a half-page description. Madison's is like 8 pages, you know. And of course, that's Madison, but still, you know. And there's a lot of misunderstandings, you know, that go through that. You know, everybody has a different interpretation of it. And I just think there's a few things that need to be cleared up and sorted out. Some words that should or should not be used or things like that. And I, by no means am I saying my vote should be counted. I'm just, you know, there's things like when you assume this position as a student rep, you don't know a whole lot. And, you know, people, they do. They make the attempts to tell you, and Dr. Carlson sat me down, but, you know, you're an ignorant high schooler and you either don't get it and you don't ask questions. And so he'll explain something and you'll just be like, yeah. But really, you have no idea. And the board policy is not helpful at all. And I understand it was only reviewed last year, but it needs to be looked at again and there needs to be some major changes to it.
So it will go to the Personnel and Governance Committee, and we'll invite Alex in to share his thoughts with us and maybe share some of the samples that he's had. Or you could go to Dr. Carlson and get those to us. But just looking for input from the board, your opinions, feelings, thoughts on this policy. If you see any major changes that you feel need to be made or...
I think that it's a hard position to be in when you can vote but you know the vote doesn't count, and you understand that anything we can do to encourage our young people to take this position with honor and appreciate why you're here and what you do for us is really important. So I think it's worth looking at again, you know, and the very reason we invite a young person is to get their opinion. Mm-hmm. And this policy, for sure, is the one that they're going to have an opinion on. So that's cool that you're going to revisit that, I think.
And the main thing that I'm have a, not a problem with, but, you know, needs to be sorted out and re-looked at it, is the seconding and motioning, not the vote counting. I have no ambitions of having my vote count because that's not my place. But seconding solely deals with discussion. and it uses the term de officio, which
ex
I...
Ex officio, yeah.
Well, ex officio, I'm sorry. That's okay. I'm thinking of de facto. Ex officio, which, you know, I think everybody has their little different interpretation of. And so if we can just clear up terms like that and lay out some bounds, because I think the ability to motion and second deals with discussion. And to take away those rights would be limiting the student's ability to speak and take part in the discussion. And, you know, that's something I want to make sure is not taken away, does not happen.
I don't think that's taken away from the school, from the student representative. You're always welcome to have discussion and give your interpretation. But we use the first and second on a vote. We use that to interpret whether we want to even deal with the topic or not. And it's not appropriate for a student representative to be dictating to whether we should take a vote on a motion in front of the school board or not. Okay. That's why you're not given the second motion.
Well,
and I think, you know, let's just take this to the Personnel and Governance Committee, okay, Alex, yeah. And we can continue. We're looking for that kind of feedback, though, from the board. So if anyone has any additional thoughts, please share it with us, and we'll have a good discussion. But Alex, just know, no one thinks you're, what did you use? You used a term that was derogatory towards yourself. What?
No, that's what he said about the policy.
They can have
ignorant or something, I think, is what you said. No one thinks you're that. We really appreciate your voice all the time. And, you know, you can speak up at any time, and we hope you haven't felt like you can't. So that's, you know, one of the things we want to make sure as you complete your term here that you're always welcome to speak. And we really do appreciate what you have. In fact, we've had many different students. We've had students that have come and have hardly said anything, and even under you know, the report time. And really, we don't get as much out of that kind of student. So we have enjoyed you coming and participating in your input. It's really been a value to us, so please know that.
But because you're not a publicly elected official, you cannot have an impact on what this board does not pass. That's why you're not given a second on this.
Well, but the second, so it has nothing to do with voting. It has to do with discussion.
No, you're wrong. If we bring a motion forward and it's not seconded, we drop the motion.
But it
as
just
a board, and that, and you cannot have a part in that.
But the second originated is mainly used as to continue in discussion.
No.
Yes.
Well, and
it's used to bring the motion forward. Mm-hmm. If there's not a second, then the motion is not brought forward.
Well,
if you bring the motion forward, second it, and bring the motion forward, then you as a representative of the students are bringing a motion forward that the board does not want to bring forward. So you can't do it.
But we can talk about it.
I can't see that happening, but I, a few times on the board, we've killed motions on the board because
for
of
lack
of a
second.
Second.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
No, you're fine. You're the Robert's Rules person at the annual meeting, and you're right, that is the language there. So, but Alex, I don't think is it on the agenda for this Wednesday for our Personnel and Governance? I don't think that it is. It may be, but we won't move it forward if it is without having you come to our Personnel and Governance Committee so that we can have a good, continue this conversation, okay? Okay, then moving on, board meeting reflection. Well, it was long, but other than that, I think we followed our norms pretty well, so thank you for doing those, for doing that. And then, Kate, if you would read the motion for executive session.
Absolutely. Be it resolved that the Board of Education moves to executive session as per Wisconsin Statutes 19851C for the purpose of considering reviewing compensation of a public employee.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded, and we need to do roll call. So, Kate, if you would do the roll call, please.
Absolutely. Gary?
Yes.
Tom?
Here.
Cheryl?
Yes.
Anita?
Yes.
Myself, yes. Tom?
Yes, I'm sorry.
Sorry, Tim?
Yes.
And Lisa is excused. All right.
Okay, we will begin as soon as the room is cleared.